presentation, reading.
Who does?
Okay.
Maybe later on, you're, no, I think, is it, I just kind of presumed this in the event. Can you read that from mobile?
I don't have it with me.
Okay.
What's your question about it?
Well, what I liked about it was that how you were able to focus on one image that was kind of nondescript in a way and made it into this kind of global commentary.
Uh-huh.
I was just wondering what kind of prompted that poem or inspiration.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if it's really, if you call it inspiration when you're angry about what's going on in the world. And I wanted, this is something I wanted to write about. And all I knew was that I wanted it to be write in anaphora, which is repetition. So I told myself every sentence must start with the. So that's all I knew when going into it. And I knew I had read somewhere about, that they were putting bombs on donkeys and other animals, and then using that to blow up soldiers. So that was just sort of haunting me. I had that I wanted to write about, and then I just gave myself this role, and I didn't know what else, where the poem was going to end up. I prefer not knowing where it's going to end up. Discovery is like the joy of writing, like not like just being lost in the writing. Like with that Parkin FAQ poem, like I was getting tired of the jokey part of it, and I just wanted to come out of it and like, okay, now I'll get serious. And so that turn, I couldn't wait for that turn.
Well, that's a good question. I mean, because a lot of your poems do traverse both those worlds, and I think it's kind of hard to go from one to the other, but you seem to handle those voltas quite simply sometimes. But could you speak a little bit about that, balancing humor and, you know, darkness, or maybe even finding humor in the darkness?
Or finding humor to talk about darkness. But I just find like that it really has to do with just who I am as a person. Like, I've always just been like sort of a prankster and a jokester. And, I like to laugh as much as the next guy or the next gal. And sometimes that allows me to talk about something serious. Because when you come at a poem, I think with this sort of, I have this like daunting thing that I need to get off my chest. There is that danger that the poem could be melodramatic or overly sincere. and so I find that humor, and it's not always the case, but like that sort of helps me get out of that sort of that dangerous territory. Yeah.
Question, we have a lot of composition students or students in here, and can you speak about maybe how can we connect creative writing like you do with that sort of classroom writing, and how have you found that in your own education and life, dealing with creative writing versus writing for the classroom, and do you find one really stood in the way of the other, or are they complemented one another, or were you able to kind of compartmentalize
them? No, I think they absolutely complement each other. At UC Irvine, I taught composition for about 5 years, and the classrooms were structured so that each professor could sort of bring in their own theme, and they can bring in like a poem or a story or an essay. And so, we talk about, who's the writer, what's the message, who's the audience, to take apart, the poems or stories that are brought into the class. And thinking about all those sort of various audiences or the mechanics of a poem, how does the form relate to the content of the poem, I find extremely helpful. I was lucky enough to get into UC Irvine's MFA program. So I was, while I was writing poems, I was also teaching composition, and I definitely saw how important that is, the composition, and think about rhetoric. communication, how that bleeds into anything. And like sometimes that's something, when I can't figure out why a poem isn't working, I'll start thinking about, well, who's the audience? Like, am I telling this poem from the right point of view? Maybe it should be someone else's point of view. Maybe that's the issue. And yeah, I don't know if that answers your question, but yeah.
How many times on average do you go to workshop and tell us before you?
Well, I'm at the point now that I don't, I mean, I revise. I don't actually go like into a workshop classroom settings that I'm sure that you have. You know, each poem is different, it's its own animal. I revise it maybe on average 50 times. This last one that I was working on, it's probably more like 100. when I think that I'm done, then I'll show my wife and then get her input. And then usually she'll like, oh, but this doesn't make sense, or is this what you mean here? And then I see like, oh God, okay, more changes. So, but I really like that process of editing. Like to me, writing and editing, they're the same thing. Yes?
I've studied a lot of literature, but I've only taken like 2 creative writing classes here at Cal State, at LBCC.
Mm-hmm.
I'm transferring to Cal State. I was just going to major solely in literature. But would you recommend that I minor in creative writing, or is that something you should dedicate yourself to wholly?
No, I mean, you could definitely get a minor in creative writing. I know some students, are you talking about Cal State Long Beach, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I know some students that, you know, they might be, you know, their major might be lit, and they decide, oh, I don't want to do this, I want to do creative writing. But I've also had students do the opposite, not so much as from lit to creative writing. You know, there is that potential, like, you might enjoy creative writing classes more than the literature classes, but I think both of those will, you know, be extremely helpful to your own writing. Yes?
Jeff Baldwin, Viking News here at LBCC. I was wondering, who are your literary heroes or inspirations?
Like right now?
Yeah.
Okay, because it changes.
Right now we're all time, because I can see the bandana, you're kind of channeling a David Foster
Wallace. You know, I was a David Foster Wallace fan for a long time, but this is only like about a year I've been doing this. And it had nothing to do with him, it was like someone else. Okay, so, but he's wonderful. I love his essays. I think his essays are tremendous. My favorite fiction writer is Cormac McCarthy. I think that's a lot of people sort of, I know it's not sort of an interesting answer, but I think he's like a phenomenal writer, and no one writes like Cormac McCarthy. He certainly has his own voice. I think about Jennifer Egan's novel a lot, A Visit from the Goon Squad.
I didn't know that, but it was on my assigned reading in high school.
You need to read it. Yeah, it's awesome. On the poetry side, I've always been a fan of Bob Hickok. H-I-C-O-K. I spelled it out because people tend to misspell that one in a really funny way. And let me see. Marianne Baruch, she's another great poet. I could go on. Laura Kaczynski. I can tell you how to spell it after.
Okay.
What's that?
Thank you.
All right. Yes?
Do you ever cite poetry like you do an ad lib? Like sometimes you just get up here and just wing it?
Well, no. Like, just come up on stage and just like, no. No, I can't. I mean, I admire, like, I love, like, over the past year and a half, I used to listen strictly to, like, indie rock, but now it's just rap. And I admire rappers who can come to a station and just, like, freestyle. Like, I don't know how you do that. Like, that blows my mind. But I can't, no, I need to compose. I need to write it down. I need to read from a page.
Because you remind me of a poetic George Carlin.
Oh, wow.
And he was awesome. He talked about the world in a funny way.
Yeah.
He was a comedian, but he was on point.
See that, I'm glad you said that because, well, that's an honor, so that's awesome, thank you. But I find a connection with comedians and like scientists, because I think they're both after the truth and are talking about the truth in different ways. Sarah Silverman, I was watching whatever her stand-ups and then Louis C.K., and I was just in awe at the stuff they were able to talk about, usually really painful stuff, and then inject humor in it. And that, I have Sarah Silverman as my epigraph for this book, but there's a poem in there called Building a Joke, where I try to take a tragedy that happened in my hometown and try to build a joke out of that, but not being able to do it. Comedians, they seem to be doing sort of, they have the same goals, I think, as writers, where they try to be concise, use the right verb, the right noun, and that's it. And they're just like, and they're talking about really heavy stuff, social, environmental, political. So I like that you saw George Carlin in my room. Oh, that's awesome. Yes?
It's kind of not too personal, but just wondering if, like, were you sarcastic growing up?
Oh, God. I need to tone it down. I'm still kind of that person. Some, like, it used to be a joke where my friend, he started this thing where he would say to me, 5 minutes. Like, I would say something, like, I think it was funny or jokey, and he would say, 5 minutes, like, give it a rest for at least 5 minutes. And so every now and then I'll get that from my wife.
No,
5 minutes.
What she was saying, like, the comedians, or I guess, like, the Bill O'Reilly show, too, where he takes the serious notes, but because of how he's saying it and he makes people laugh, just how you're reading the poems, it raises people.
Bill O'Reilly?
It's not Bill O'Reilly, but it's one of those guys, like one of the talkative guys. It takes very...
Bill Maher?
And one someone like...
Yeah, yeah.
They take the, you know, it's just very sarcastic.
Yeah, Bill Maher does that, yeah.
So that's what he's wondering.
But you know what? Honestly, like, not all my poems are that way, but I find, like, humor is a great way to connect with an audience. And so it's more to put me at ease to read the funny poems or the ones that are sarcastic that I think I know that might get a laugh. And so I feel like I could settle into my own skin and just be comfortable with it. Let's read something serious. Yes?
Come up through the Long Beach schools, or do you remember the first time you were impressed by a teacher's opinion of your writing?
I mean, the first creative writing class I took was at Cal State Long Beach, and it was 20 years ago, and my instructor, Haley Mitchell, she saw something there, and I wasn't sure. I had just recently changed majors from art to creative writing. I'm still not done with art. It's still like in my blood, but Haley was like sort of like, yeah, you need to be doing this, and then sent me off to take Charles Webb's class, and he was encouraging as well. So yeah, 20 years ago. Yes?
I'm going to ask the politician about the process, and thanks for being here today.
Oh.
Because you do have a natural sense of humor, sarcasm, but in your writing process, do you find that sometimes you're at odds with the need to edit and craft and that you lose some of the ease and the humor? And how do you, if you do, you wrestle with that? How do you have fresh, objective eyes to go back and hear your joke or the ease all over again?
I mean, that's why I keep revising, because when I'm working on something, how I feel about the poem or the story doesn't mean I will feel that way the next day or even a week from that moment. That's why I take a while to revise, because I feel like there's something that happens, you know, we all know that we shed our skin, that I think my eyeballs, that I shed the skin off my eyeballs, and then I'd be able to see the poem with a fresh pair of eyes, and then see, you know, you guys are in school, so you don't really have the luxury of, like, I'm gonna wait another week to finish this poem or revise it. But yeah, I mean, that's sort of, you know, whether or not the humor is working in a poem, I have no problem with this. You know what, I'm gonna write this one at a serious angle. It's not like a thing that I feel I need to do in my work. Sometimes, you know, it depends on how I'm feeling that day when I'm writing. Yeah. I don't know if that answered your question. I didn't.
Well, it's just the ease, like
the ease
to bring, because it's so beautiful and it comes and it's funny and we can laugh at it. But sometimes I find I can write the ease out of the poem and then have to look at it again and bring it back, or I lose it if I'm overworking something. I guess that.
Oh right, yeah. I mean, I don't know, it's weird, because the more you work, I mean, you could be writing about something that's really like personal and heavy, but the more you work and edit it, you sort of become, I put myself at ease by working on it for a while, and then I won't be emotional when I'm reading it the 50th time. But there have been times where I'm like, you know, I'll read the poem and then I'll get emotional because I haven't read the poem out loud. But that's only happened like twice. But yeah, I find like, I don't know, like the more you say something, the less it weighs on you in a way.
Thank you.
Yeah.
What got you into writing?
What's that?
What got you into writing?
I didn't even hear the first part.
Oh, what got you into writing?
Oh, what got me into writing? I think reading. Like, I always read, you know, in the beginning it was Stephen King and Mary Higgins Clark, who's like a thriller writer, and then I moved on to, you know, literature, and I never thought I would write books at all. I thought I was going to be a visual artist, but I just fell more and more in love with writing, and then, you know, I was writing bad poetry in my sketchbook. And I don't know. And then I was reading more poetry, and I was like, "Oh, okay, I've been doing it wrong." So I think reading was the thing. And I wasn't reading a lot of poetry; it was more like fiction. Yes.
How do you decide a set, like say for an open mic or even something like this? Like, do you have poems that have more of like a voice tone to them? Like, you think they'll sound better out loud, or do you just decide this is funny?
That one. Yeah, because it's like, again, like I want to be able to connect with the audience, and I did this reading. It was, you know, for my second book, which is kind of dark, and then I remember just reading it, and it was just one miserable poem after another, and then the audience was just like quiet, and then. Yeah, I didn't want to do that anymore. I wanted to mix it up. So yeah, it's not necessarily. I feel like I'm not. I don't go at it to a reading and think, okay, I think these are my best poems and I'm gonna read them. I go at it as, okay, these are the ones that I think I will get a reaction from the audience. These are the ones I think I'll be able to connect with the audience with, and I might put in a serious poem or two that I think they might get it, so. Yeah.
Approximately, what's the shortest and the longest time it has taken you to finish a poem?
Well, early on, when I was writing, there were days where I would write a poem in a day. That would never happen now. Never. I like the process of revisions. So, you know, in the early 2000s, it would take me a day to write a poem, and then maybe 5 days later I'd write another poem that would take me a day. But now I could struggle over a poem a month. But I'm teaching too, so I'm doing other things. Sometimes it stretches longer. Sometimes I'll write a poem and I think it's done, and I'll send it to a literary magazine with some other poems, and they'll reject it. And then I'll look at the poem again, like maybe 4 or 5 months later, read it, make additional revisions. Sometimes I do revise it when it comes back, sometimes I don't. So it takes a long time now. But I like it, I like doing that. I like the work. Yes?
What classes do you teach at Cal State Long Beach?
Fiction and poetry. Are you going there?
Mm-hmm.
I have a question from a professor in the corner over here, Valerie.
Oh,
yes.
I wanted to ask, I normally think of you as a poet, largely as a poet.
Yeah.
I wonder if you could talk about what drove you to write the two novels you've written, and also how your process of writing fiction is different than it is for poetry, isn't it?
Writing fiction, especially those novels, is torture.
for a poet,
I mean, it's like someone giving you a spoon and saying, dig a crater. you know, I was just reading a lot of fiction, and I thought, you know what, why not? And so I started writing, Sucker Punch, the first 50, 70 pages, I showed my wife, and she said, this is good, but this is young adult, and blah, 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 and I just heard young adult, and I was like, oh, no, it's lesser than, I had this stupid reaction to it, and then I put the book away, and it wasn't until probably like 5 years later, at an awards ceremony, they were giving out awards for young adult fiction, and one of the books sounded really interesting to me by Adam Rapp, called Under the Wolf, Under the Dog, and it sounded like really dark, and I was like, wow, I gotta read that. And so I read that young adult novel, and it just blew me away, because it was poetic as well, and then so I just saw that young adult is, it's just a label, and I'm like, who cares? And so that really pushed me to write that first book, Sucker Punch. I wanted it to sell. I didn't know if it was going to. My plan was to, let's sell that and then I'll write poems again. And I got a 2-book deal, which surprised me. I was thankful, but then I was like, here's another spoon. I was like, shoot. So, but it gave me confidence to finish that second book quite quickly. But I have a third book that's I'm struggling with, a novel, and I'm pulling that apart and finding stories there and trying to get those published. But poetry is my main go-to. Yeah.
Oh, with your novels, when did you decide it was done? Like, how did you decide this is done? Did your wife help with that?
Yeah,
or?
She did.
Yeah.
Yeah, because she's a novelist primarily. She writes fiction.
Okay.
She helped me. I was a baby about it. She'd be like, it's not ready. You have this. And I was like, oh, shit. I wasn't sure until she read it and I was like, okay, I think it's done.
Okay.
Let's try to get you an agent. You know what, I had 100 pages. The book wasn't finished yet. I had 100 pages. I was able to get an agent, and he said, I could try to sell it with, the first 100 pages, or you can finish it, and it might be easier if you finish it. So I decided to do that. But yeah, all of, my wife helped me throughout that process. Anyone, yes?
Conversely, how do you know when the poem is done? How do you know when a poem is done and you're not overworking it?
I never know.
Okay.
I feel like it's at that moment it's like just a snapshot of where the poem is, and I just like it gets to the point where like okay, I don't know what else to do, like but I'm open to suggestions for like sometimes an editor will tell me like yeah, we'd like to publish that poem, but we have a couple minor like tweaks, and are you okay with it? And of course, it's like, yeah, that's so much better. And I never completely know.
Okay.
Yeah, it's like maybe like I'm 90% sure that I know that it's done.
I'm just curious, following up that last question, do you feel the same way about visual art, about knowing when it's done?
Oh, visual art?
Yeah.
No, you know what? I feel more confident when I think, yeah, this is done. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know why. Yes?
Being somebody who revises your work a lot, do you ever, like when you're reading right now, do you think, I should have done this?
Yep.
Yeah.
Whenever like a new book comes out, and it comes in the mail, I can't bear to look at it. Like I didn't actually start reading these poems until like maybe, you know, like a week before my first reading, because I know it's just like I want to change it. I'm such like to me it's all about the joy of writing. The process, writing the poem, being immersed in the poem, and feeling like I'm wrestling with something that's nourishing for me, that I can't get anywhere else. And so the book kind of feels like old photographs of yourself. Like you're kind of embarrassed to look at them. Yeah. I don't really grade like give a grade to a poem. I give a grade to revision. I have them turn in the old version and then a revised version. I want to see effort there in terms of revision, and that they're not just changing one or two words. I mean, some poems that's the case, but most of the time it needs a complete makeover. But I would never write on a student's story or poem A or B plus. Like, I mean, it's art. I can't do that.
David, thank you for this afternoon.
Thank you guys.